Hello everyone, my name is Abhilash Saini and I'm a professional geophysicist currently working on ground penetrating radar. In this video we are going to take a look on the theory and terminologies of ground penetrating radar. Content will be component of GPR, working of GPR, definition and terminologies of GPR, in which we will talk about mainly type of scans, what kind of frequency spectra is there, and what kind of physical property that we are going to discuss, and signal and the gain. So talking about the component of GPR, basically a GPR is consist of many kind of segments. Basically the TX and RX, as you can see in this picture, are the transmitter and receiver, where the functions of these component are transmitter transmits the signal into the ground, and the signal get reflected back, and RX receives the signal, and it goes back to the signal sampling and digitization, and then data storage and signal processing and display. All is in single unit called the receiver. Basically sometimes the control unit is controlling all these kind of segments, this TX and RX. So basically there in this picture there are four reflector, R1, R2, R3 and R4. So basically the signal will be transmitted back to the receiver with according to the dielectric contrast between the layers, and recorded accordingly. So here is a example from sensors and software LMX 200. As you can see on the top of this instrument, we have a control unit, and it is capable of doing line scan mode with the split view, which is a kind of module in it, and grid scan and map view, and there is some kind of functionality using Wi-Fi on site, mini reports you can generate, all this kind of thing. You can use external GPS, as you can see here, and the GPR sensor is on the bottom with a wheel which is capable to record the distance of each and every trace accordingly, and usually the technology has moved forward towards the external GPS, which is capable to do all sort of positioning issues are solved basically using the GPS. And so what is the working? As you can see here, the picture of this person is getting blurred. So basically from left to right, he is walking with this GPR unit, and this subsurface is getting mapped. So as he comes from the position from x0 to further x1, x0, x9 up to xn, so basically we are getting the image on the left hand side, on the bottom, the wiggle plot you can see, and we are going to discuss about the wiggle plot more in next slides. So we get this wiggle plot. So basically a hyperbola will be generated on this subsurface utility called CEL, and this wiggle plot is then converted to the pictorial representation given on the right hand side on the bottom. This is the working of GPR. So basically what will be the definition and terminologies of GPR that we have to know? Basically a wave, on the left hand side you can see a wave is consist of some crust and some troughs. This is basically disturbance in some sort of field, and in GPR we are basically talking about electric and magnetic field which are perpendicular to each other, and both fields are perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave. So two consecutive crust or two consecutive troughs, the distance between these consecutive crust and troughs basically gives the wavelength lambda, and amplitude is basically the magnitude of the disturbance from the mean line, this dotted line. And Basically, the frequency is the main factor that we have to discuss, and frequency, velocity, and wavelength are correlated with the formula mu is equals to c by lambda, where mu is the frequency, c is the velocity of the wave in the medium, and lambda is the wavelength. So basically, frequency and wavelength are reciprocal to each other, and Earth acts as a low pass filter. So basically, the low frequencies, basically the higher lambdas, will be penetrating more in depth. And on the left hand side, you can see a trace on the left hand side. Left hand side, basically, you can see the amplitude and samples are on the measuring axis. And sample is basically a single wiggle that came from the transmitter of the GPR system, sorry. And these samples, we can vary the number of samples. Basically, we have 200 or 250 samples per pulse, and all these pulse then join together to make a 2D, and then those 2D sections will be joined together to make 3D images of subsurfaces. And here there is a term called zero point. So basically, zero point is the point where the interaction between the wave and the subsurface begin. So we have to be very careful about it while making the topographic correction for the GPR processing. So on the left hand side and right hand side, basically these two images represents the same geology and same subsurface, but the presentation is very different. Seen back in the days, as I've discussed the history of GPR, you can go for that video also. The wiggle plot was in the early stages of GPR, where the traces are collected accordingly, and then this new technology in which the wiggle plots then converted to the line scan, the pictorial representation, where the grayscale is used. Basically, there are more than like so many kind of color palettes are available, but gray, I prefer gray because gray has 16 different scales in single palette. And the dark color basically represents the trough, and the white segment of any hyperbola, that represents the crust of the samples that we sent into the subsurface. So here is the frequency spectra. Basically, for starting from the left to the right, you can see the electricity, radio, television, cell phone, microwave, infrared, up to gamma rays. See, all these vary according to their frequency and their wavelength. But we are considering only this orange segment here, which is responsible for the GPR investigations. It starts from around 1 megahertz or 5 megahertz to up to 10 gigahertz. Usually, we use a different kind of frequency for different kind of application domain, because all application depends on what kind of depth that is required, and what kind of gain functions that we have to apply. So basically, gain is not dependent on the spectrum, but the application domain. Basically, the depth of penetration is totally dependent on the frequency. So basically, higher the frequency, less the penetration, and vice versa. So here we go for the some for some you see some parameters that we have to know before digging into the technology of GPR. One is the dielectric constant. So dielectric constant or permittivity is just a property that describes the ability of material to store electric energy by separating opposite polarity charge in space. So its unit is farad farad per meter, and we don't go for the dielectric constant, but we go for the relative dielectric constant or permittivity. So basically it's the ratio of permittivity of material to the free space. So there is no unit for the relative dielectric permittivity. And electrical conductivity, electrical conductivity, the ability of material to support the electric current, a material property that describes the movement of electron or ion within due to applied electric field. So this is the, you see, property that may define the gain function of the, you see, our scans or our signal that we send into the material. See, if the conductivity is very high, then there is very low kind of signal strength that we are going to get, and we have to apply. So here are some parameters, dielectric parameters of some very common material of investigation that are, you know, listed in this table. So it goes around like 1 to 81. So basically all the parameters, all the material has the range of dielectric permittivity, relative dielectric permittivity between 1 to 81. That all depends on the amount of saturation of water in within the materials. For example, we have dry clay, it can be 4, but if clay gets some sort of saturation, then it goes on increasing, the conductivity will increase, it can go for up to like 20 up to 30, depends on the amount of water present in the vicinity of the material. And for one great example is for the metals, metals have infinite dielectric permittivity. So it's not like dielectric constant, it's a relative dielectric constant. So it goes like infinity, and its contrast is very identical, if very 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 easy to identify, very easy to identify, and hence metallic objects are very distinguished as compared to non metallic material. So as we talk about the signal, so basically there is a reflected signal. Basically there are so many type of signals. There is reflected, refracted, and transmitted. All sort of signal are present in the same diagram right on the bottom of this slide. And on the right hand side we can see a formula. Basically for example, if we have a reflector R1 and R2, and imagine the signal is going from R1 to R2, and the dielectric property, relative dielectric and dielectric properties are defined accordingly, eta epsilon R1 epsilon R2, and then we can calculate what sort of strength that we are going to get in the reflected signal using this formula. So coming back to another slide, as you can see on the left hand side, there is a chart that is showing the attenuation factor alpha with respect to frequency. So the frequency range is between 0.001 megahertz to up to like some sort of gigahertz. So the variation of the curve basically in the same proportion, but in the range between 1 to 1 megahertz, you can see GPR plateau. So the attenuation almost remains constant as the frequency increases. So what is the importance, what is the, you know, significance of gaining the signal? So as the conductivity increase, the signal get dissipate, but we have to increase the signal appropriately. So basically what we do, we design a function that can be multiplied or get convolved with the existing signal and enhance its features so that we can see what is actually beneath. So on the left right hand side, we can see three images of a profile on the top on the top and the middle. We can see there is a, so basically on the top the background filter is not applied, but on the second image background filter is applied. So basically we have to see if we have to see only the gain, then in the B and C image we can see the enhancement as we apply the gain function to the profile, so that we can see what kind of features are present in the subsurface.
Any particular type of topics that should be covered in this course, please let me know in the comment box, and please like, share and subscribe. Thank you.